welcome to the podcast. Today we are talking with Director John Wallis with regards to the new Labour government and their proposals for renewable energy. Welcome, John.
Hello.
You've not been on the podcast before.
Haven't.
So if you could do a brief introduction to yourself for those who do not have the pleasure of already knowing you.
Thank you. Well, I'm, like you say, John Wallis, director here at Grays. Been involved in the company now for just over 11 years. And I head the energy team, hence why you've asked me to come and chat about energy.
Absolutely. Okay, so you're involved, so you're head of energy. In what way are GSC Grays involved in renewable energy projects?
Yeah, okay, so there's kind of two phases to what we do. One, which is the larger grid scale developments, where we act on behalf of landowners, advising them on things like solar farms, wind farms, battery storage sites.
Yep.
And then we also do some what we call on-farm renewables, where we look at smaller scale developments, trying to reduce farmers' energy costs and try and mitigate some of their costs through the business.
So what is then, what's the opportunity for landowners? You've talked about why we are involved as a company, but what is the opportunity for landowners with renewable energy?
So I think if we look at the bigger developments first, so we're probably involved in 40 to 50 of these scale projects across the north of England now. Okay. And as a firm, we've been involved for probably over 10 years. The majority of the schemes we're involved are sort of grid scale solar farms and the battery stuff as well. Now, for those developments, really, you need three things as a landowner. One, you need grid connection. So you need to be relatively close to the grid to be able to connect in feasibly. Secondly, there needs to be capacity within the grid. And thirdly, you need planning consent. So often we come across clients who like the idea of a renewable energy scheme, but they fall down on one of those three things. So generally, we will work with a farmer, landowner, an estate, try and look where their opportunities are, see if they've got any grid infrastructure within their boundary, and then we'll approach developers and look to see if we can realise an opportunity for them.
And are these very profitable opportunities? I assume, you know, kind of what sort of scale are we looking at?
Yeah, so if we looked at solar first, generally you have to have a certain scale to make it financially viable. Okay. We're looking at really anything over 120 acres to get to that sort of threshold. Battery sites are quite a bit smaller. They can be anything between 2 acres and 30 acres, depending on the size. And from a from an income point of view for the farmer, yeah, it's it can be life-changing, if I'm completely honest. If we looked at the solar farms, the rents for solar farms at the moment are anywhere between £850 to £1,200 per acre per annum.
Right.
So it gives a really good guaranteed income for the landowner.
Okay.
And this sort of scale scheme, generally the structure that we put in place is a lease. So, you know, the farmer isn't involved in running it, managing it, building it. They are ultimately leasing their land to a developer for a period of time, and they receive an income every year from it.
Okay, and there's plenty of these projects ongoing at the moment, and they've nothing to do with the new announcements other than, so if we could talk about sort of what the recent, you know, what the government are looking to do, because there were changes announced sort of from the previous government, and are they all staying, and then what the new government's saying, if you could just talk us through that.
Yes, there's a couple of changes at the moment. So we've seen a big influx of these type of schemes over the last 5 years, and that's largely because ultimately the financial viability of the projects has gone to the right side.
Okay.
So we didn't see any of these type of schemes built for a long time once the subsidy went. But what's happened more recently is the price of the equipment has come down, solar panels, batteries, and obviously the energy price has gone up. So all of a sudden these projects are viable by themselves, and hence why we've seen, you know, you've seen it in the press, there are lots of these schemes coming forward.
Yeah.
Where there is a challenge is the grid. So the grid capacity is running out. The grid in the UK has been designed so you have central power stations feeding the power out. We're now trying to put power at the end of the branches and feed it back in.
And
it's just causing a problem. So both the last Conservative government and Labour have seen this as a priority to try and increase the capacity in the lines, improve the infrastructure so these schemes can come forward. Because ultimately, they're not taxpayer funded, they're all private finance, and it's, you know, real positive thing. So we have a number of clients at the moment that are stuck in the grid queue, ultimately, where they've made an application, they've got their planning potentially, or they're going into planning, but they haven't been able to connect to the grid. So what the Conservative government did via the DNOs, the district network operators, they changed it around a bit. So historically, it's been first come, first serve. So depending on when you made your application, whereas now it's depending on how progressed you are with your project, basically. So if you've got an option agreement in place, or if you've got planning consent in place, you could move up the queue quicker. So that will unlock some new opportunities for both our clients and other clients across the north of England.
Okay, Brilliant. So, and then the new Labour government, what proposed changes are they bringing in?
So Labour were very clear in their manifesto that renewable energy and UK-based generation is one of their key aims. And we've already seen some changes come into place, even in the few weeks that we've had this new government. So first of all, they altered some legislation regarding onshore wind. So that has been stuck, basically, onshore wind. I won't go into the technicalities of the legislation, but there's a footnote that's been removed from the legislation, which means that onshore wind is now back on the cards.
Okay.
So we have a number of clients who we're working with to try and bring onshore wind projects to the market where they've been stalled for the last sort of 10 plus years.
Right.
So that's one thing. And then the other thing, Ed Miliband is obviously the Energy Secretary. He has already approved 3 very large-scale solar farms that were also stuck in planning. So there's clearly a move towards being more positive from a planning perspective.
Okay, brilliant. So a lot more opportunity, particularly with wind. And I guess, is everything kind of ready to go with that? Is there, you know, if somebody you've talked about solar, if they're now interested in wind, it's something that's been mothballed for a while. How do they get going with that? Is it just much the same as with a solar farm?
Largely the same. I mean, we have been working with a number of clients already in the background working on these wind projects with the intention that there would be a change in government.
Yeah.
So we have clients who are almost ready to go to the market now with projects because they've been proactive. I would say time is of the essence because just like the solar and the battery work we've been doing, grid will also become an issue just in terms of capacity. So the sooner people can put the hand up and say that they're interested in a project, the sooner we can do the due diligence, try and involve a developer and take it forward.
Okay. And are there any sort of negatives that sort of when people are looking, you know, it all sounds great, you know, oh, there's an opportunity, get in touch, get plugged in, get loads of money. What are the pros and cons? Is there anything that people should be aware of?
Yeah. I mean, with everything in life, there's no such thing as a free dinner. There are positives and there are negatives. Positives are clearly the financial rewards, which are, you know, strong, certainly. And also they have some longevity to them as well. Most of these schemes are 40 years plus.
Yeah.
The rents are index linked, so they'll gradually build every year. So from a financial point, clearly great. Some of the negatives which just need working on are, I would say the tax planning needs to be considered. Generally, agricultural land is favourable from a tax perspective, particularly inheritance tax. If you let land on a long-term agreement for one of these types of developments, you lose APR and BPR.
Okay.
So tax planning is something that needs to be considered. And then there are lots of technicalities within the contracts themselves that's why we always say try and get advice as early as possible. Things like decommissioning, that's a big consideration because whilst the schemes are operating, great, but what happens at the end of the term when there's a big cost to decommissioning? We spend a lot of time negotiating really clear and detailed decommissioning clauses so that the landowner is protected.
Okay. Right, so plenty to consider there. Mm-hmm. And as always, best to get advice as early as possible.
Absolutely.
All right, so we've talked about the large-scale projects. What about the smaller-scale on-farm projects? Because that's something that we've been doing a lot of, isn't it, through our Farm Business Advice Service and what a lot of farmers will be looking to try and kind of, you know, protect themselves, if you like, from fluctuations in costs. So if you could talk me through some of the projects we've been doing.
And again, it's a similar type of position to the bigger stuff in that the cost of the equipment's come down. As you said, the energy price has fluctuated hugely, particularly in the last 2-3 years. So farmers are looking to be more resilient, have more energy independence and not be so reliant on the grid.
Yeah.
So we've done a number of projects for farmers, both privately and through the FBAS scheme. Where we've looked at installing their own equipment. And then generally that's been rooftop solar, but it's also been some battery stuff and wind, like we say, is sort of coming back on the scene as well. And ultimately they're trying to generally mitigate costs, but that isn't always the only driver.
Okay.
Often, you know, they might be looking at reducing the carbon footprint if they've got contract with some of the big supermarkets and they want to be carbon neutral, that clearly helps. So there's other reasons other than just purely cost, but what we will do is we go in and look at your energy profile, both now and what the next 5 years might look like, and then try and design a scheme that works with that energy profile to reduce costs as much as possible.
And is there a certain scheme that seems to work the best from most farms in general?
I mean, it's very much dependent on the type of farm.
Okay.
So we do a lot with hens, we do a lot with pigs, because a lot of their energy use is in the summer when it's hot and they've got the fans going. So from a solar perspective, that works really well.
Yeah.
Obviously, big grain dries and harvest are okay, but very seasonal. So you design a really big scheme to work through the harvest, but then the rest of the year it's slightly redundant.
Yeah, what do you do with
So that? It's working out where the right pinch point is, basically, in terms of scale of the scheme. And what we're seeing now is that the export price has increased quite a lot in the last 2 or 3 years. It wasn't very long ago where you were getting a few pence to export back to the grid. We're now up to sort of 15p plus.
Right.
And actually that then just changes the dynamic again and brings back that payback period.
Because that was the other thing I was going to ask, is it's not going to be cheap installing, you know, a lot of the infrastructure that's required. So then what does that look like in terms of return?
I mean, the best we've done is probably 2.5 years payback, which obviously, I mean, you would invest anything at that kind of return. But that's where the energy profile matches perfectly with, you know, daylight hours and summer months and that sort of thing. For some of the other, you know, the big harvest projects and things, you could be up to sort of 7, 8, 9 years, but still that's, you know, better than a 10% return. So it still works.
And so then where does wind fit into that? Because we've been talking a lot about solar, and obviously that's very, you know, I suppose, with turbines, when it's windy, it's going to be better. But does that provide a more consistent?
It does, yeah, certainly more consistent. I mean, we are trying to look at including batteries more on all of our schemes, so that even if the energy profile doesn't match perfectly with when the resource is available, we can store, which helps. But wind will certainly work for some businesses, particularly where, you know, milking often works quite well, because generally the milking hours are in darkness, particularly through the winter.
Yeah.
And if your windmill's still going around, it helps.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's very much, you know, farm dependent on what type of technology is going to suit better.
Okay. So it's get someone out, get your energy profile sorted, and have a real, you know, due consideration as to that your farming type, when you'll need the power, and then that's when you need to have a look at everything else. Okay, anything that we've missed, John? I feel like that's been quite a whistle-stop tour of both, you know, the larger scale and the smaller scale. Like, what does the future look like for the sector, I guess? Kind of a sort of a bigger, you know, the new government's sent a really clear message and has started momentum down this path. What does the future look like?
I think we'll continue to see change. The big energy developers have sort of adapted to the market really well in the last few years. At the beginning, you know, they were doing 200-acre solar farms that were working really well. They then started developing these battery storage sites, which helps balance the power in the grid, which has been good. So another opportunity for farmers. And then more latterly, they've looked at these really big schemes, sort of 2,000-acre plus, where the grid connection maybe isn't great, but because of the scale, they can travel a bit further with the cable. So the developers are always adapting, which is good. Wind coming on the market, back on sort of the market, is going to be a big change. And that's where a lot of our clients will pick up new opportunities. And the third thing, with all of this new grid infrastructure going on, there will be more infrastructure on the ground, and that will be overhead lines, it will be new substations, underground cables, just the amount of infrastructure that the government are going to have to implement over the next 5 years is going to be vast. And so whilst some of our landowning clients might not be able to build a solar farm, they may have some of this infrastructure forced upon them ultimately with new CPO rules as well.
Sorry, CPO, what do you mean by that?
Compulsory purchase orders.
Okay. Yeah.
which is basically the government's way of putting this in.
Yes.
Without consent from the landowner, with consent. So what we always advise there is, again, approach us as soon as possible. We can help. Fees are normally covered anyway, which help, but it just means that we can get the best deal possible for you if you're affected by any of this type of new infrastructure.
Okay. And so just to kind of clarify, so that was what you mean is a farmer or landowner will be approached, they'll get a notification that something's going to be put on their land.
Yeah.
And we can support them with objecting, with negotiating.
Absolutely.
So can you talk us through, because some people might not be aware.
Yeah, so there's always an element of consultation at the beginning, and we can help them with that. And if they, you know, like you say, if they want to object, or if they want to try and at least consult and move some of it potentially, or if it's coming and it's happening, we would basically negotiate the terms with highways or whatever type of infrastructure is. And that would be compensation for crop loss if it's just temporary, but if it's long term, it's easements, it's way leaves, and it's just really making sure that their interest is protected, which it should be.
Okay. So just to let people know, they are entitled to advice that will be covered.
Absolutely.
And so they should speak to somebody as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Okay. Brilliant. Anything else you would like to add or that people should be thinking about, John, when it comes to renewables on farm?
I think the only thing I would say is we often come across clients who have looked at this type of project in the past, and that might be a big grid scale project like we discussed at the beginning, or it might be an on-farm project. And often they get to the point where it hasn't happened for whatever reason. You know, if it's the on-farm stuff, it might be because the feasibility financially didn't work. And if it's the grid stuff, it might have been a grid connection issue. Because everything's changing so rapidly at the moment, both in terms of grid and legislation and costs, I would just recommend people pick up the phone. We can have a chat. We can see if there's any new opportunities available to them, and we can help them take it forward.
Okay, so a scheme that has been refused in the past actually might have the opportunity to...
Absolutely.
To be approved.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that's very good advice. Thank you very much, John. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
And thank you for listening. For more information on the Labour government's new policy changes and how they'll impact on landowners and farmers, keep an eye out on our podcast channels. Thanks for listening.